What up, y'all, and welcome to another TBT Difficult Bebop Lines. And so, if you're new to the channel, my name is Aaron. I do practice tips, trumpet tutorials every week. So be on the lookout for that. If you're interested in that, then go ahead, subscribe, and hit the bell so you're notified anytime I upload or I go live. Staten, what's up? What's going on? Good to have you. So today, I'm just gonna go over how I like to practice bebop lines that are really hard, and I feel like I'm never going to get this, but it's all with just slow practice. So if you guys are in here, go ahead and let me know who your favorite trumpet players are, you know, your name, you know, where you're from and all that stuff, so I get to know you guys a little bit better. All right, so this past week I've been learning this a new tune. And it's this bebop tune called, Ornithology by Charlie Parker. And there's two versions. And the version I'm learning, though, is, hey, what's up? Staten from Cali. Oh, you're in Cali, but you're from New York. Awesome. So I'm learning this tune, and I'm listening to, and plus, this tune is really fast, no doubt. So I'm like, how am I going to try to play this ending? There's different endings. So sure enough, you know, I did some practicing with it, and it sounded pretty good. So if you guys want to hear, I'm going to play the melody. Bazzarini, what's up? He says, hey, Aaron, good to see you. It's 9:30 in the evening here in England, and I'm sitting here with a beer looking forward to another great lesson. Awesome. Alfred, what's going on from Alabama? Staten, I beat my harmony mute up a bit and it sounds better. Yeah, I have my cup mute right here. My harmony mute is in the other room. But yeah, there's 15 folks in here, so just let me know who you are, say what up, and let's get started. So I'm gonna play this melody for you. Now I've been learning. So it's still a little rusty. Zachary, what's up? Hi, what's going on? Cortland, he says, hey, from Miami, I have a list of trumpet players, Leroy Jones, Roy, Hargrove, Miles, from Meat and Potatoes. Lead players are Roger Ingram, Marcus Zaus, I think that's how you say his name. If not, then I'm so sorry for messing his name up. I even like listening to Trombone Shorty. Trombone Shorty is amazing. I've never heard him live, but he plays the heck out of trombone and trumpet. It's kind of unfair. But it's real cool. I don't know how he's able to do that by switching mouthpieces, though. Like, I remember I was doing my brass studies during my undergrad, because I'm music ed, and it was tough trying to get back into the flow of things, you know, after I played trombone or tuba. Man, it was such a big difference. Oh yeah, so let me go ahead and play this melody for you guys. And then what we're gonna do is I'm gonna teach you the line, note for note, and kind of analyze it to tell you how it's kind of constructed. Hen says, what's up from Germany? And it's 10:40 p.m. here. Thanks for the lesson. Man, I appreciate everyone that's here and it's really late. Wherever you're from, 10:40 p.m., 9:40. Man, I appreciate all you guys sitting here and being here with me at so late in the evening. So thanks. So yeah, I'm gonna teach you the line, and then we're gonna practice it together. Really slow. We're gonna do it really how I like to practice it. So we're gonna go through that process. All right. So here we go. I'm gonna play the melody. Should I do mute in or mute off? Should I put the mute in? You guys wanna hear with a cup mute or just straight from the horn? Mute in, no mute. A little bit of both. If I had two horns, maybe I would be able to do that. Straight, all right. So I got a little bit of both, no mute, so I'm gonna go with no mute. John, what's going on? All right, so here it is. Also, if I'm looking good, like, or well, not me personally, but if the video is looking good and if you can hear me, put a number one in the chat. If you can't really hear me or see me really well, just put a zero in the chat and I'll see what I can do. All right, so here's the melody. Line there, but so that's the line that we're gonna go over today, man, because I was having such a hard time with that, and that's actually slowed down. All right, Alfred says one, Zachary says one, everyone's saying one. Thank you for helping me out, guys. So doing that melody alone, that's at a slow tempo, you know. I was just being safe. But yeah, that last line, that was a killer, man. So I'm gonna take you through. First, let me teach you a line. So what's happening there is, descending minor chords from, it's gonna be R, C sharp, B flat instruments, C sharp minor, C minor, B minor, and then B flat minor, I believe. No, C sharp, C, B, and then it goes to, a F there, or A major chord, something like that. No, right. So C sharp, C, B, B flat, A, then it goes to the tonic chord, A. So we land on that tonic chord. So it goes down chromatically, minor third, or minor chords. So here, it's just alternating minor arpeggios. So first we ascend C sharp minor. So C sharp minor is C sharp, E, G sharp. So that's the first part. Then it goes down C minor. So it goes up C sharp, E, G sharp, then down G, E flat, C. Then it goes right back up to B minor. So B, D, F sharp. Yeah, Han, ornithology. So I'm learning that tune kind of right now and trying to get it better. So now, then it goes down to, it goes down from B flat minor. So F, D flat, B flat. And then it lands on the tonic chord. So without there's also notes in between there. So there's like leading tones to each of the target notes. So I'm just gonna play the arpeggios alternating without the leading tone. So that's like the skeleton of it. So if I need to go slower, I'll go a little bit slower. Who's my favorite trumpet player or my favorite player? Right now, my favorite player is Tom Harrell. He plays, his lines are just so perfect. like the shape of them. Like if you transcribe a Tom Harrell solo, and you just see the shape of his lines, it's just like a masterpiece. and I like his sound and his phrasing. After his time, because he sounded like Lee Morgan for a short period of time, and that's not the period that I enjoyed. The period that I enjoyed was when he got more into his sound, and I love his playing. So that's my favorite trumpet player for right now, like one of my top five. All right, so now what happens is a leading tone, kind of an enclosure, but I'm gonna call it a leading tone to the target notes. So we're gonna play our C sharp minor arpeggio going up, and then we're going to do a leading tone to the next chord tone. So we're gonna do it's an enclosure. G sharp, F sharp to G. So that's going to the fifth of the next arpeggio. So let me play it down just in case, because it's a hard line. It's a hard line because not only is it arpeggiated, but it's also in a difficult tessitura for people that are like in the beginning stages of their development. So it's kind of hard, but I'll play it below the step. Well, not below the step, but I'll play it down the octave. C sharp, E, G sharp, F sharp, G. And then now we're gonna go down the C minor arpeggio. So now we're gonna do a leading tone below to hit that next target note, which is B. Okay, so we have this so far. So now we have that. Now we're gonna go up the minor arpeggio, starting on B. Now we're gonna go one half step below the target note, which is F sharp. I mean, which is F, natural. So now we're on the fifth of B flat minor. So now we're gonna go down. So we have this, starting on B minor. So now we have this. We have this line so far. Starting on C sharp going up. Now we're going to go down the B minor, the B flat minor arpeggio, starting on the fifth. And then we're going to hit the note below our next target note, which is A. It's a half step, so it's going to be G sharp. So now we have this line. Starting on C sharp, we're going to go up C sharp minor, down C minor, up B minor, down B flat minor, then to our target note, which is A. So that's it, that's the line. So I'm gonna teach you how I practice it and how I like to go about playing difficult lines. So I got some questions here. Deadass says, hey Aaron, how do I do vibrato for jazz music like Louis Armstrong? Now there's different types of vibrato. You can do vibrato with inside your oral cavity by saying ooey 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 or ay 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 ay. I'm kind of going inside my mouth and saying ay 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 ay. Or you can do hand vibrato, and you can kind of rock your hand back and forth. And that's what Louis did. He did that and lip vibrato. But so that's two ways to do vibrato. Like so in order to do that, to do the mouth vibrato, I suggest that you do some lip flexibilities. There's lip flexibilities in the Arbenz book. I think it's page 87, I believe, page 87. If not, then just find lip trills or lip flexibilities and you'll be able to see it. Can't you do it with your jaw? I mean, it's all connected. It's all connected. The jaw, the oral cavity, it's all connected. Yeah, no problem. So Staten, yeah, you can do it with your jaw, but you can think about it that way, but it's all connected, your oral cavity. So the inside of your mouth, the tongue, the jaw, everything. All right, so how I'd like to practice it is I like to start at the end of the line and work backwards. So let me put on my metronome. So if you guys are enjoying this lesson so far, don't forget to hit that like button so this lesson can be seen by other folks so I can help them as well. All right, so I'm going to put my metronome on at, I think, 60. Maybe, let's do 60. So I start from the end and I go backwards. So this is the line. All right, so now I'm gonna start backwards. So the target note is A. I'm gonna do the and of four. And I'm gonna work backwards, note from note. One, two, three. So also what I'm doing, I'm singing the line. So I'm singing the line inside my head and waiting for the chance to play those notes. So I'm still playing it in time, but I had the line in my head already. You're listening to me while you walk your dog. That's awesome. All right, so next I'll do the next note. So I want to sing the line in my head. So I'm going to sing it out loud so you guys can hear it. One, two, one, two, three. That's what I meant. I'm trying to sing and play at the same time. So here's the two notes. So that's coming in on four. Ba-do-da. Now I'm going to do the and of three. So I'm working backwards here. So that's the next note, which is D flat. One, two, three, four. Now I'm gonna do two beats. One, two, three, four. Now I'm gonna do one note before that. Alderson, I'm sorry, I cannot read that. Not sure what language that is, but I appreciate you joining in. Staten says, do I play any other instruments? I do not play any other instruments. I'm just dedicated to the trumpet right here. All right. All right, so now I'm gonna play the end of two. Now I'm gonna play two. And so now I have to keep track of which note and which chord I'm on. So I'm gonna play C, F sharp. One, two, one. So I'm just doing note by note. One, two, three, four, one. Okay. So that's what I do. One of those words looks like excellent, so I take it as a compliment. Yeah, I saw that. So whatever he said, I'm so grateful for. I'm glad you like it and everything. Victoria, trumpet and guitar are my favorite instrument. That's awesome. I wish I could play guitar. All right. So I'm just going to speed through this. But this is my process. I go from the last note to, and I just add on notes. B. And the note before that. One, two, three. All right, now. So I think you guys get the drift, but yeah, so that's how I practice it. I go from the target note, and then I just go backwards. I start from note, I go backwards, add a note, and then I put it all together. And of course, it's good to record yourself and listen back, and also play it slowly, so you're able to make it feel easy. So one thing that if something is really hard or difficult to do, it's in order to take out that tension that you get anytime you see like a very hard lick, is to slow it down, make it where it's easy and you don't have to think about it. So then again, another good way to practice really hard licks is to, especially if you're trying to focus on air, is to slur it all. And make sure everything is nice and even. So even, I won't even swing it. It can be that straight. And all I want to focus on is making sure each note is nice and even. My sound is nice and clear on each note. And yeah. Victoria Nicholson, do you think I could get away with playing a trumpet in an apartment? Well, I'm playing in my apartment right now, so yeah. it just depends on when you practice, right? Because you're not gonna practice like late in the evening unless you put a mute in, like a practice mute in. So I'll be very careful about that. But yeah, but if it's a problem, if someone's like banging on your door or whatever, just ignore them. That's happened to me in other places. Like they're stomping on people from upstairs or maybe stomping on the floor or someone's banging upstairs, but that was in another place when I was in my undergrad. But who cares, man? Practice, you need to practice. So don't worry about anyone else. Just be considerate on when you practice, like the day or the time that you practice. Dario says, sorry I missed the theory today. Which lick? It's it's the ending of Ornithology. So it's this lick. So that's the lick. And it's tough, man, especially trying to play it at a fast tempo. On the recording that I'm listening to, it's Charlie Parker and Miles Davis. Is it okay to start with a plastic one? A plastic trumpet? I mean, I've never played on plastic trumpet, so I wouldn't know. I wouldn't know. But I guess if your budget or whatever, if you need a plastic trumpet, you know, just for travel or whatever, then that might be easier. I don't know. I've never played one. All right. But that's pretty much it for today. I just wanted to tell you guys that to slow it down and start from the ending. So because I noticed like anytime I started at the beginning, if I started at the beginning of the lick, it was hard to, I just end up fumbling my way to the end. So I started from the end and just worked my way back. One note at a time. Now it's tricky because I don't have the music in front of me, so I have to use my memory. I have to use my memory to figure out what note came before, right? So even if you want to practice it with the music in front of you after you've learned it by ear, of course, and then that's fine too, because I'm kind of struggling trying to, could I give you any guitar tips? I would say listen to great guitar players. That's number one tip. Number one tip, listen to good guitar players. And of course, get a guitar teacher. But of course, I'm not that. I'm just a trumpet player. Mr. Hazelhorse says, what do you think about using third valve instead of one and two? Can you play in tune like this? Third valve, for which note? For the A. It just depends. I would say get used to, for E and A. I would say get used to the regular fingerings. Get used to the regular fingerings. And I will only use alternate fingerings if there was a tuning problem. So for instance, A's, anything with the first valve is usually pretty sharp. And if I can't fix it, you know, while I'm on stage on the bandstand with my tuning slide, and then I'll try to figure it out if I can do it with the third valve. Because, yeah. Are trumpets tuned? How does the Byzantine trumpet differ? I don't know what that is, but trumpets are tuned, like it's made out of tubing. So one way to tune it is to manipulate it by using the valves. Oh, not the valves, but the tuning slides. But the main tuning slide kind of controls the overall tuning of the instrument. The other slides, they help with notes that fit in that valve. So for the third valve, use the third valve tuning slide. Anything that you use the first tuning slide on, use the first tuning slide, first valve tuning slide. So yeah. Email, what's going on? Zachary says, thanks for the tips. Unfortunately, I forgot my trumpet at school, so I couldn't play along. Nope, you still got school? It's not over until, what, June? But man, how you gonna practice? You gotta be able to practice, man. But I mean, this will be available on the replay, so you'll be able to practice along with that. Yeah, no problem, Mr. Hazelhurst. Thank you. I'm glad you guys like the show. Like I just try to think of things that you guys might like, might enjoy, or learn, get some value from. Because these are all things that I wish someone had taught me, you know, when I was coming along. Things that I've discovered kind of by myself, just practicing or just experienced along the way. Let's see if I missed any. Dario says, which patterns are you doing? The pattern is, and I said it before, it's minor chords going down by half steps, starting on RC sharp minor, so C sharp minor, going to C minor, to B minor, to B flat minor, and then to A. I think it's to A, but the pattern is, it's arpeggiated, so it's arpeggiating those chords, so going up one, going down the other, going up one, going down the other. But it also has leading tones going into the target notes. So you're either landing on the one or you're landing on the five of the next chord. Bazarine says, I like a bit of Till Brunner and Brian Corbett. I haven't heard of those two trumpet players before. I'm gonna have to look them up. Yasmin says, what do you think about the Martin Committee trumpet? I don't know. I've never played it. If you guys have tried it, then let me know. Mr. House of Horse says, I usually hurry home from dance school to get the last part of it. It is 11 p.m. here. Oh, nice. You're in dance school. Awesome. Email says, I can't stay. Have a lesson. Thanks for joining, email. Victoria says, you want to learn any guitar from me? I wish I had a guitar. So you can actually, I'll get into this too. Like if you're trying to improve your bebop chops or whatever, use bebop tunes as your guide for language. Because it was interesting because I was practicing this tune here in the living room with my wife just sitting next to me, and I was practicing it and, you know, playing along, and she was like, oh wow, is that a solo? I was like, no, it's a actual melody, but these tunes, like, they're solos in and of itself because of the language that's in it. So it was just funny that she mentioned that, or just said that, like, oh, are you practicing a solo? Because it sounds like a solo. Bazarine says, you have to listen to a distant episode by Till Brunner. Gorgeous. Is your wife a musician? My wife, we met in high school in band. So she played clarinet in high school. And but she's not a musician now. That clarinet is like in it's in the closet right now as we speak. But she's a medical resident right now. For pediatrics. Dario says, which books do you suggest to improve bebop language? I would say if you want to get an understanding of like bebop scales and stuff like that, start from the source. Not only the source as in like the recordings, but the source who kind of deemed the term series of books called How to Play Bebop, and it's three volumes, volume one, volume two, volume three. Volume one, it teaches you about the scales and how to ingrain the scales. Volume two is just a book of licks. Volume three, it teaches you and gets you into the process of learning bebop tunes, or learning tunes in a bebop fashion. And it takes you through that process. And so one of the processes that he talks about in that book is using bebop tunes as melodic material and how to extract that melodic material from those tunes. So one thing you can do is practice this pattern in all 12 keys of the chromatic scale. So if you get the pretty much the concept of this lick, is alternating minor chords. So going up one and then going down the other with a leading tone. So, and then going down a half step. Then with the leading tone. Right? Then you can practice that pattern in all 12 keys. I froze when I said the book name. That's great. So the book name is, hopefully I don't freeze again. The book is called How to Play Bebop. There's three volumes. So there's volume one, which teaches you the scales. Volume two, which gives you just a whole bunch of licks. Volume three is, it teaches you how to learn tunes, learn bebop tunes. But I would suggest that the best teacher is the recordings. And there's a CD that I recommend. So let me get that real quick. So this is the CD that I got. This was actually one of the first Miles Davis or any jet, the first jazz recording that I bought. And then I got. It was right after I saw a concert with with Joshua Redman, a saxophonist. It was here in Chicago in the Symphony Center. And after that, my grandmother and I went to the nearest record store, and I got three albums. I got this Miles Davis Timeless album. I got another Miles Davis tune. Got two other Miles Davis recordings, CDs. And I recommend this because it has pretty much all the quintessential bebop tunes that you need to learn in this CD, on this album. So you can take a look at that. And these are all the tunes that that David Baker recommends that you learn as far as learning bebop tunes. So yeah, get this album, Timeless, Miles Davis with Charlie Parker. Has his face on here. But yeah. Yeah, David Baker. Cortland says, in some solos, I hear a guy playing bebop licks, and I can't tell if it is all tongued or if certain notes get that attention. Do you think it's dealer's choice, or is it stylistically required? There's certain things that with bebop phrasing or just jazz phrasing in general, and I'm kind of maybe overgeneralizing things, but follow the shape of the line. So like with dynamics. So if a line is going up, you want to crescendo. If the line is going down, you want to decrescendo. That's one way. Another thing you want to do is, not every eighth note is created equal. So there's certain eighth notes that you want to bring forth and bring more, you know, attention to. And those are usually notes, the highest note, first the first note of the phrase gets an accent. Racist eighth notes. Right. The first eighth note or the first note in the phrase gets an accent. The highest note also gets an accent. So since we're starting on the pickup, that pickup note is going to get that accent. So that top note, that G sharp is going to get an accent as well. So not only the first note of the phrase, but the highest note in the phrase is going to get an accent. And I'm not tonguing every note. Even though Miles Davis, he does tongue all the notes in that recording. But for my style, or for what I'm hearing, is is different. Also with that, you want to, with something that's concrete, or not concrete, but constant eighth notes, me personally, I try to make sure I emphasize the downbeats. So ones and threes. So that's just one of many ways that you can stylistically play eighth notes. And even then, like, I'm not really swinging. I'm just kind of playing it straight all the way through, because at faster tempos, the straighter the eighth notes need to be in order for it to sound like it's swung. Because if you swing really hard at a fast tempo, A, it's really hard to do. Because the notes are different values, and B, it'll end up sounding really choppy and not smooth. So in actuality, the faster the tempo, the straighter the eighth notes need to be. Yeah, groups of threes. Cortland says, I usually try to group them in threes or fours, but I thought I was just giving up, and I don't have the endurance with the tongue speed. I don't really tongue that much when I'm doing the line. I'm just tonguing the important notes, really. By just focusing on the important notes, it kind of sounds like all the notes are being tongued in a way, especially at a faster tempo. But yeah, groups of threes or groups of fours, definitely. Yeah, Dario Baker. So David Baker. What up, John? Good to have you in the stream, John. All right, y'all. So yeah, so that's what I do. When there's difficult bebop lines to play, I start from the end, and then I work my way back. One note at a time, and then I play it in sections. I bring it all together, and I target the spots that are giving me trouble. The high power. Please do a Fats Navarro lick. I would if I knew one. But if you learn, like, bebop heads, those are bebop licks in themselves. That could be your language. And then, like I said before in another masterclass, someone was asking about how to find your voice. Finding your voice is just a combination of your inspiration and then your creativity. Staten says, how do you move the tuning slide so freely? Lots of slide grease. So make sure your tuning slides are nice and oiled, or yeah, good amount of slide grease on there. And yeah, that's how I do it. Do I have to use the slides? I personally recommend that you use slides I recommend that you use the slides because it'll help with your overall intonation. Because going from note to note is everything's not going to sound in tune from the note before. So if I play a scale, right? I'm going to play a scale, and I'm not going to use a tuning slide. I'm not going to use my tuning slide, so I'm going to play just a B-flat major scale. So there was a few notes that were really out of tune. So I used the slides to help me listen for the center of the note. So slides help. I recommend that you use them. Bazarine says, how do you decide when to take a breath? By the phrase. It depends on the phrase. If the phrase is, that's how I determine it. If the phrase is a 2-bar or 4-bar phrase, then I'm going to make sure that I have enough air or enough air to get me through that phrase. But what kills it is slower tunes or slower melodies. And you have to play like a 4-measure phrase. You just have to take in a good amount of air and just learn how to control, it's breath control. Learn how to control your, how you blow the air out and not just like blow all the air out in just one go or on one note. A good book to learn how to control your breath or to have good breath control is The Irons book. And I use that to help me with my breath control. And the first page, page 5, that's the killer right there. So I would suggest if you're working on breath control, work on that on page 5 of The Irons book. All right, Victoria, thank you for joining me. All right, if there's any other questions that I can answer, any questions whatsoever, then please put them in the chat. Or if you have them if you're watching the replay, go ahead and put them in the comment section and I'll answer your questions. But yeah, that's pretty much it. I'll play the melody again if you guys want to hear. If you guys want to hear me play Ornithology again, then let me know. Whether it be a PDF of the lick. No, I'm not going to put a PDF on for the lick. It's just better. It's just so much. I was telling a student of mine who's in the chat, I think. I was telling a student of mine that jazz is a aural, A-U-R-A-L, music. And the best asset that you can have with this music, the best asset are your ears. Your ears are the best asset. And everything that, the one thing I would say if anyone should improve on, you know, to play better solos is to improve their ear. And of course, just better technique on the trumpet, but ears are everything. Because on the bandstand, you're not going to be reading a solo. You're going to be trying to listen and hear the thoughts in your head, hear the melody and the music in your head and trying to convey that out on your horn. So I strongly recommend that you learn music as much as possible by ear. As much as possible. John says, I hear you. Cortland says, I like learning by ear, but it feels like a blessing and a curse in the same. It's just a slow process. That's the curse. But it gets faster. The more you do it, I promise you, it gets so much faster. And yeah, when I was in high school, you know, I was good at improvisation only because I had good ears. I had no idea what I was doing. I was never taught, you know, chords or what, you know, chord scales were, or I didn't know what the cymbals meant. I just used my ears and I just played. What I played, I don't know, but apparently it was good enough. You know, Corlin says, same here. I didn't learn all that theory until later in undergrad. Or not undergrad, but I learned theory my junior or senior year at a community college before I went to the university. And that helped me a lot to really ace the theory classes in school, you know, in university, because I was exposed to it. It was nothing new. So I had an easy time in theory class in college because of it. Satan says, I have an idea about theory. What do you mean by that? Corlin says, I feel so behind a lead player. You feel behind it as far as like improvising or theory knowledge? Like, what do you mean? And also, oh, theory? Well, I mean, here's just a way to just simplify it. The chord, if you see a chord, it's either a major chord, a minor chord, or a dominant chord. If you see a diminished chord, just that could be substituted as a dominant chord. If you see an augmented chord, that can be substituted as a dominant chord, just with a sharp five. Now, if it's a diminished chord, just think a major third below that, and then that's the dominant chord. It's all the same notes. Corlin says, I have a basic understanding, but once we get into jazz, it gets a little harder for me to process. I don't have the ears to listen to a chord and name it. So a good way to practice that is if you have a keyboard or even if you have an iPad, download, if you have an iPad or whatever, download the GarageBand app. It's free. And what you can do, a good exercise to do is compare really opposite chords. So extremes, compare extremes. That's what I'm trying to explain. Compare extremes. So one extreme is all major. The other spectrum of that is diminished. So you get a sense of what that sounds like. All right, so here's a major chord, just on C. Let me turn this up. Can y'all hear this? That's a major chord. Now, if I say, now this is a diminished chord, a fully diminished chord, a triad. Can you hear that? So I'm just using the GarageBand app. All right. So this is different. This major chord is a lot different from this chord. All right. So if I put names to this, and this is a book that I'm stealing this idea from Greg Fishman's book, Lobster Theory. So check that book out. It's just a bunch of great analogies about jazz, but this is an analogy that I like to use or teach, like ear training. So let's call this, and he uses like the names of like apples, and I forget like the names of apples, but let's say this is this chord is red delicious apple, and then this chord is, what's the most sour? This is a green apple. Let's just say this is a green apple. That's a green apple, right? So if I play any note, I would usually tell my students, okay, recognize this chord. Is it a red delicious or is it a green apple? So I'm gonna play a random chord. Let's see. Is that red delicious or green apple? Okay, good. All right. Is this red delicious or green apple? Someone said GBD. John says red. Okay. All right. So let's do something else. Is this red delicious or green? Apple. Green. So yeah. So from that, from doing things like that, Staten says a rotten apple. Yeah, that definitely sounds like a rotten apple. But going from different extremes from that, that's a way to really fine tune your ears. And then you go from the less extreme. So the next extreme would be, the next chord would be a minor chord. So that's the minor chord, right? And then I would add in that chord to end the mix. And then I would call that chord something else, another type of apple. Then I would say, is that red delicious, or is it green apple, or is it pink whatever? So that's one way to train your ears. Also sing a ton, sing a lot, sing every day. But if you're watching this, and if you're on the live stream, and if you're on the replay, let me know, like, what is the one thing that you guys are having trouble with that I can make a video on? Give me any suggestions that I haven't done that I can do, because I want to help you guys as much as possible in on this channel. So yeah. So just let me know either in the chat if there's what's one thing that you're struggling with. That I could potentially help you with. I have buddies with master degrees that are like, that's a sharp 9 chord, and I sit in silence. How do they hear that so quickly? Well, it's just getting used to that flavor. It's just a different flavor. So, for instance, I know, just sit with the flavor a little bit. So, if you're able to create a play along, like if you have your I Real B, just make up a chord progression or just put chords together, and they all have to be sharp 9 chords. All of them need to be sharp 9 chords, and just listen to that and get used to that sound. Like, play it every day, play along with it every day. And then throw in another chord in there that's not a sharp 9 chord, so you hear the difference. But yeah, I would do that for all chords. Like, do it for minor chords, major chords. Sharp 9 chords are altered chords, because it's a flavor and you just got to get used to it. So here's a sharp 9 chord. And all that is, it's 1, 2, 3 with a flat 7. So that flat 7, and then on top of that is a sharp 9, or you can think of it as a flat 3rd, a minor 3rd. So here we go. Here's... So it has a flat 3rd on top. If you want to think of it as a flat 3rd or a sharp 9. And then that sharp 9 is this note. So that's the sharp 9 chord. So just get used to those chords. Staten Island says, "What other kinds of music do you listen to?" I listen to the what people call mumble rappers, like Lil Pump and like so trap music artists. I try to listen to a lot of stuff, because you never know, even if I don't like it, you know. So I try to listen to things that and pick certain things out, certain elements that I might like. you know, and I just sit with it, and yeah, I just listen to it. So I like hip hop, of course, you know. I wanted to know all this as I'm getting into composing. Thank you. Octaves make the difference too, but from what I understand. Yeah, definitely. Have you heard Rigor Mortis by Kendrick Lamar? Of course, I've heard that. Corlin says, thank you for being patient with me. Yeah, no problem. But yeah, so if I was in your shoes, I would definitely, in order to get, to improve my ear and like be able to recognize chords, you know, take a few days, like take 2 weeks or a week at a time, or a day. Well, let's say a week. A week on each chord. So practice and improvise over a major chord. Just listen to major chords. And then the next week, just listen to minor chords. And then the next week, just listen to dominant chords, and so on and so forth. Just so you can get used to that flavor of that sound. I'm trying to learn it. Oh, I'm trying to learn it. It's like merging both genres together. You're trying to merge hip hop and jazz together. I mean, that's being done, but what comes into play is your creativity and how and what you do with it that no one really else is doing. Because really, I mean, merging two genres isn't just about putting a backbeat, you know, calling it hip-hop, jazz, or whatever, putting a backbeat on some changes and calling it hip-hop, jazz. That's not really what it's about. It's the elements that make hip-hop. It's the elements of jazz that make jazz, and then, or any other music, and trying to merge those two things together. I think the person that, or the musician that's really doing that the best is Christian Scott. I really, even though he has his Christian Scott sound, his, you know, the composition, he's doing it in a way that no one else is really doing it. Most of rap is based on jazz. I mean, rap is the grandchild of jazz, and jazz is the grandchild of blues. So it's all in the spectrum of black music. It's all in that lineage. I'm just saying I like how it works in both genres. Yeah. Corlin says my phone is doing whatever it wants. No problem. John says, now that I have memorized UMMG, which is Upper Manhattan Medical Group, if you guys don't know, and internalize the art form aversion, my next step is the outlining the chord and learn the scale starting on all the chord tones. Any other suggestions? That's a good place to start. Learn his solo. I mean, jazz isn't all about, I mean, scales and chords are cool, but you have to get into that language part. And that's probably priority. One of my top priorities is being able to get that language and internalize it as much as possible. So yeah, get a solo. Use that, maybe get that Art Farmer solo if you like it. And transcribe that. Transcribe it by, like we talked about, transcribe it by ear first and learn it on your horn and worry about writing it down later. Right? So internalize it first. All right, but y'all been great. John says I like Tom Harrell. I'm working on his solo. Oh, okay. Oh, Tom Harrell has a version of it? I'm gonna have to listen to that. You know I love Tom Harrell, man. But yeah, guys, I really appreciate everyone joining in and staying tuned to the masterclass. This one was just, I felt like it, people might find it interesting on my process of just learning how to practice bebop lines that are difficult. And of course, play it slow, but I like to start at the end and work my way back, note for note. So that's my process. Staten says, thanks for all of the new knowledge. Man, I'm glad you guys are enjoying it. I'm glad you guys are enjoying the stuff that I'm putting out. I really appreciate y'all. Bazarine says, great, thanks. Lots to work on. See you next week. I'll definitely see you guys next week. Also, it's the summertime and falling rain. Hello, what up? It's also the summertime. So this next time in June, or in June, I'm scheduling around some students to learn, or to teach them privately. So if you guys are interested at all with studying with me during the summer, I do Skype lessons. I do also work with WhatsApp, Skype, anything that you guys would be able to contact me through. So I do lessons, and I'm in the middle of scheduling people in for June. So if you're interested at all, go ahead and go to the description box, and it's that first link in the description to schedule a lesson with me. And if you guys are interested, go ahead and do that. But yeah, one thing that I also noticed is that students, when it's the summertime, students stop taking private lessons, which is crazy because that's the time to work on stuff is the summer. So if you need some guidance, if you like to learn from me on more of a one-on-one type of basis, then go ahead and schedule that lesson with me and just click the first link in the description, and we can get started for sure. All right, but that's it for this lesson. I appreciate everybody that has joined me, and we are 6,400 people strong in this channel. So that's what's up. Guys, share this video or share my content with other folks so they can learn just like you. And I'll see you guys next week. You guys have a great night, great day, depending on where you are, and take it easy. All right, take care, folks.